Okay, so we go on to the next topic.
Yeah, sure, that
This
works for me.
sounds like this might be your favorite one, morality.
This is, again, not an expert yet, but this is something I've spent more time focused on a personal level. And it had
Okay.
a deeper impact on me personally growing up.
Well, maybe we can take about 5 minutes each on this. One thing I wanted to ask you about was a lot of in debates on morality, Christians will say that atheists have no basis for morality and that they're just stealing from the Christian worldview, which I think is totally silly. I believe that the basis that morality is all about behavior, good and bad, and good behavior helps the community and bad behavior is what hurts it. And that's why we say don't kill, and that's why we say it's good to feed the poor, for example. You don't know if you're going to be poor or not, so it's nice when you look out. So it's kind of a no-brainer, is you don't need God for that. I had a and so I one thing I find is interesting is that I think there's some very to say that God is the basis for morality. There is some really gross immorality in the Bible prescribed by God, some of his commands. And one of them is I showed you on Twitter the other day about Numbers 5 about induced abortion, the priest, how the priest can do an abortion. How about if I read the passage on that and talk about this for a few minutes, and then you can tell me what you would like to talk about from your position.
Sure.
Okay, so I'll read this. Numbers 5. It's called the test for an unfaithful wife. So if you're a Hebrew and you believe that your wife is unfaithful, but you don't have proof for it, this is Numbers 5. It says, "Then the Lord said to Moses, speak to the Israelites and say to them, if a man's wife goes astray and is unfaithful to him so that another man has sexual relations with her, and this is hidden from her husband and her impurity is undetected, since there's no witness against her and she has not been caught in the act, and if feelings of jealousy come over her husband and he suspects his wife and she is impure, or if he is jealous and suspects her even though she is not impure, then he is to take his wife to the priest. He must take an offering of a tenth of an ephah of barley flour on her behalf. He must not pour olive oil on it or put incense on it because it's a grain offering for jealousy, a reminder offering to draw attention to wrongdoing. The priest shall bring her and have her stand before the Lord. Then he shall take some holy water in a clay jar and put some dust from the tabernacle floor into the water. After the priest has had the woman stand before the Lord, he shall loosen her hair and place in her hands the reminder offering, the grain offering for jealousy, while he himself holds the bitter water that brings a curse. Then the priest shall be put the woman under oath and say to her, if no man has had sexual relations with you, and you have not gone astray and become impure while married to your husband, may this bitter water that brings a curse not harm you. But if you have gone astray while married to your husband, and you have made yourself impure by having sexual relations with a man other than your husband, here the priest is to put the woman under this curse. Quote, may the Lord cause you to become a curse among your people when he makes your womb miscarry and your abdomen swell. May this water that brings a curse enter your body so that the abdomen swells or your womb miscarries," end quote. Then the woman is to say, "Amen, so be it." The priest is to write these curses on a scroll and then wash them off into the bitter water. He shall make the woman drink the bitter water that brings a curse, and this water that brings a curse and causes bitter suffering will enter her. The priest is to take from her hands a grain offering for jealousy, wave it before the Lord, and bring it to the altar. The priest is then to take a handful of the grain offering as a memorial offering and burn it on the altar. And after that, he is to have the woman drink the water. If she has made herself impure and been unfaithful to her husband, this will be the result. When she is made to drink the water that brings a curse and causes bitter suffering, it will enter her abdomen will swell, and her womb will miscarry, and she will become a curse. If, however, the woman has not made herself impure, but is clean, she will be cleared of guilt and be able to have children. This then is the law of jealousy, when a woman goes astray and makes herself impure while married to her husband, or when feelings of jealousy come over a man because he suspects his wife. The priest is to have her stand before the Lord and to apply this entire law to her. The husband will be innocent of any wrongdoing, but the woman will bear the consequences of her sin. So, I mean, the weird thing there is that a lot of Christians, especially Catholics, who are the biggest denomination by far of Christians, would say that, you know, abortion is sinful under any circumstance. And here the priest is actually, seems like the priest is actually doing it in the case of a guy suspecting his wife. You know, basically it's called the test for an unfaithful wife if the husband is jealous. So what do you think about that?
Well, I think there's a lot of things. For one, again, you could spend a lifetime just going through each and every thing in the Old Testament. But as to this specific one, you're reading out of a very specific interpretation or translation, as it were, of that scripture, which uses the word miscarry, which is not used in other versions. And it's also, there's no other mention, other than the word miscarry, there's no mention of her being pregnant. So jumping into that being an abortion is, to me, a bit of a stretch to claim that.
So are you saying, are you saying that's a bad translation? There should be a better way to translate it?
I would say so, yes.
So what would be a better way to translate it?
Well, I'm not a translator, so I'd have to go back in, but that's the general, when I went through and started looking at that to answer your question, that was the general consensus, was that was one specific translation in the 2011 NIV, mm-hmm. but that the rest of them aren't, there's maybe like one other one that translated it that way. So, but in any case, I think that's really looking at one very specific thing and ultimately missing the point of the claim that atheists are cherry-picking Christian morality. So, I mean, you can go through. I will submit to you that there are lots of stomach-churning things in the Old Testament that seem contrary to our current ethics, and I think there's probably a reason for that. But as to your broader question, I think there's maybe some other things we can talk about, because I would agree that ultimately atheists are borrowing from a Christian perspective, both historically and philosophically.
Well, we can talk about that from atheists. I'll give you, some time to talk about that. But I wanted to explore some things on this. One thing is the NIV, the NIV says, it talks about miscarriage. And here it says too, what is the NIV? And it was a big translation thing. There was 15 Bible scholars using Hebrew, Aramaic, Greek text, whose goal was to produce a more modern English version text than the King James Version. And so they try to use more modern language. And if you look at the other versions,
it's also
for,
not a word-for-word translation. It's a thought-for-thought translation.
Well,
you're
like
not necessarily even getting the original. I mean, you're trying to translate it into English out of the Hebrew, and they're not. Mm-hmm. It's not going word-for-word.
Right, right. Yeah, that's what I want to say. Like, for example, the New Revised Standard Version, it says, on verse 22, it says, "Now may this water that brings a curse enter your bowels and make your womb discharge, your uterus drop, and the woman shall say amen." There's another translation called God's Word, and this one says, "May your stomach swell and your uterus drop." And I thought, what does uterus drop mean? And so I looked on the internet, and what happens is, this is actually kind of a rare case, but it happens frequently for a rare case, I guess, is that a woman's uterus can actually fall out because there's muscles holding it in, and they're weak. And they say now there's a surgery where you can tack it up again. So this is saying basically the uterus is going to fall out. And then how do those...
mean that she was pregnant.
Well, if her husband suspects she was fooling around and this curse goes through, if she was impregnated, that's only going to be abortion right there.
If she was,
yeah. If she was,
presupposition that she was pregnant.
Yeah, but the whole point though is that she was fooling around, they think. Well, the other thing I wanted to say too is that all these other translations, they all talk about thigh. They say instead of like your uterus drop, they'll say your thigh to rot. Your thigh to rot. Well, what can thigh to rot mean? And they say this basically is kind of a euphemism, this thigh. I mean, sometimes in the Bible it's translated as loins.
Right, so...
So basically it just means the reproductive areas or the sensitive areas. I mean, you don't think a woman's thigh is really going to rot. I mean, that doesn't make any sense to say her thigh. Which thigh? I mean, the right thigh?
Some kind of damage to the reproductive area. Yeah.
Yeah.
Whether or not there's a baby involved would be a separate issue, I would suggest. But
So, and you know, the other thing about this verse too, it just kind of shows to me like there's magical thinking going on, like we're going to give this potion. I mean, of course, Jewish people wouldn't do this. Nobody would do this today. And you might say that was a special time. Back then, God did miracles, but it just seems like this is kind of showing the magical thinking to me that the Bible is rife with.
Yeah, I mean, we could go on for a long time, you know, dissecting every verse. If you had told me you wanted to discuss that specific verse, I would have done more research on that. Again, you know, there's, you can cherry pick any verse in the Bible and say, well, explain this and explain this and explain this. And, you know, there's answers available for those things, but I'm not an encyclopedia where I can go in and say, oh, well, this is, you know, this is what the original Hebrew meant just off the top of my head. So I'd have to go and actually look at that.
Well, I'll tell you, I went on BibleGateway.com and I looked at some of the commentaries on there. They had quite a few. And I looked on verse 22 specifically about the miscarriage. And it's kind of funny because a lot of them had comments about it, but they had comments on verse 22. They were explaining the last part where it says, amen, amen. It's like, are you kidding me? You're explaining amen, but not the main point of that sentence? So I just thought that was kind of funny. But unless you have more to say about that, you can bring up, now what would you like to say about morality for me?
Well, so I just, because when I was an atheist or an agnostic, as it were, atheism seemed like a pretty bold claim, but I was an agnostic and a strong agnostic. I had ethical issues. So I thought maybe you're familiar with Will Provine.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, because I think he takes a very, I appreciate his what his perspective was. He's passed away now, but I think his perspective is pretty honest about things. He said,
yeah, he was in the Expelled movie.
Was he?
Yeah, that's...
Okay, yeah, he may have been in that. That makes sense. Right, but he's an atheist.
Yeah, they tried to make him look really bad in that movie, yeah.
Sure. Well, his statement, I think, though, is really honest, and I appreciate that. He says, let me summarize my views of what modern evolutionary biology tells us loud and clear. There's no gods, no purposes, no goal-directed forces of any kind. There's no life after death. When I die, I'm absolutely certain that I'm going to be dead. That's the end for me. There's no ultimate foundation for ethics, no ultimate meaning to life, and no free will for humans either. So I think he strikes on some things. And so to me, there's a lot of problems with trying to develop an ethic without God. And there's a lot of evidence for that. But I would just ask you, it seems to me, Bernie, when I hear you talk about ethics, that you presuppose some things. So for one, I'd ask you, where do you, what gives you the right to ascribe value or worth to humans? Because that's inherent in your claim, right?
Is that, well, like I said at the very beginning, morality is, see, like math is all about numbers. Morality is all about behavior. It's that simple. As math is to numbers, morality is to behavior. So then you say, what is your good behavior and what is bad behavior? Good behavior is stuff that's good for society, and bad behavior is stuff that harms the society. So that's the big picture.
But you can't say that.
Why not?
It's begging the question. Like, how is it that you're defining morality, like, from, you're going backwards. How is it that humans have value and worth? How is it that society is what is good? Like, protecting society is what is good. Where do you get that from?
Well, when I say,
like, what if,
okay, let me take it one step at a time. When I say morality is all about behavior, do you think there's a problem with that statement?
No, I agree.
Okay, so that's self-evident. And then if I say good behavior is what's good for society and bad behavior is what hurts the society, you're having a problem with that statement?
Absolutely.
That's like, it's obvious
because
that... It's obvious that, you know, if you look like Maslow's pyramid, you know, there's everybody at the very bottom. You need to get security, you need to get food, you need to get shelter. And then as you go up, you get more and more actuated.
But you're presupposing humans as the ultimate thing to be protected.
It depends. I mean, morality could be expanded to taking care of the animals and the earth and everything else.
Well, what if I tell you that I think that humans are a parasite or a plague, and that creation itself is what should be protected, so I should wipe out all of humanity. What would stop me from doing that, ethically?
What would stop you? Well,
I mean, ethically, what's wrong with that?
Well, let me give you a similar experiment saying. Like Sam Harris talked about this. You know, he talked about morality, and he says, like, you know, some people say, like, well, how do you know? Similar to the question you gave, and he goes, well, look at health. We want to have good health. And what would you say to somebody who said, like, well, I believe that we should be just, I don't believe that we should all, I don't think good health is about, you know, being well fed and feeling good. I think good health is about throwing up every day and having pain in your back and sores on your feet. I think that's what good health is. I mean, if health is about being healthy, why, I don't understand why it's complicated that if you want to have a good society, that's what morality is. That's what, I don't understand why that's controversial. That has nothing to do with God. So I'm not really sure why.
Because who says that society is a thing that should be protected? Ethics are a form of protecting something, right? Or promoting something. And ethics, what you're saying is the ultimate thing to be protected and promoted is society.
No, I'm saying ethics are about behavior. And when you talk about behavior, behavior is for the society, correct?
But you're talking about the consequences of behavior, and the thing that that you're trying to protect from or promote through certain behaviors is society. And I'm telling you that you've made a big leap there in assuming that society is that thing that should be protected and promoted mm-hmm. through behavior.
Well, like I said, but math is about numbers, and you could say, like, well, why does math have to be about numbers? Maybe it should be about letters. Well, math is just defined about numbers. It's dealing with numbers. That's what morality is. It's dealing with behavior, and good behavior is what's good for the community. That's why we all know this, and that's why if somebody came to you and said, you know what, God spoke to me. He said he wants me to rape that woman over there. You can't say, like, oh, well, whatever God told you is fine. You got to say, no, that's wrong. Why? Because you know that's bad for society if people went around doing that.
But where do you get philosophically, where do you gain access to the right to say that society is the ultimate thing that should be protected?
Like I said, that's like saying, why do you say math is about numbers? It's just,
I don't think it is.
It's just by definition.
What is to say that, like, why would humans be more worthy of being protected than the creation itself? I mean, there's a lot of people that are leaning towards that direction. You talk about people who are, you know, wanting to reduce population and such like that because it's bad for the environment.
Right.
What is ethically wrong with me wiping out 90% of humanity for the sake of the world?
You know, it's like in an airplane. When the airbag drops, they say take care of yourself first and then your passenger, your child or something. That's the way the earth is. We are the stewards of this earth because we are the most intelligent. We are the apex predator here. We are in control of everything. If we don't control ourselves, we will destroy the earth. We're on a spaceship earth. We need to take care of this like a hamster cage. If we just wreck it, it's bad for everything. So we need to take care of ourselves and other species.
But again, why should we protect it? Let's just look at one human life even. Why is that one human life worth protecting?
Well, because like for society, based on reciprocity and things like that, you want to help other lives because you would like them to help you.
Why?
If you help other lives when they need help, reciprocity means they would also help you when you need help. This is society helping each other.
But why? Why should we help each other? To what end? What's the value in it? What's the worth of it?
To have a thriving society. It's that simple.
Why should we have a thriving society?
Because everybody wants to live in peace. They want to be satisfied. They want to be well fed. They want to be entertained. Those are all good things. They want to feel fulfilled.
You're begging a lot of questions here, but we can move on from that question because it doesn't sound like you're really, I mean, you're just saying that it's self-evident is essentially your answer. It's self-evident that humans are the most valuable and worthy thing to be protected in creation.
Well, the reason I said we had to put ourselves first, like the woman in the airplane with the airbags, because we are the apex people in charge here.
Does that matter, though? I mean, we're killing all these other animals. We're destroying the earth.
Right.
I mean, if I'm taking an evolutionary perspective on things, an atheistic evolutionary perspective, I'm looking at humans as a parasite that need to be exterminated for the sake of the rest of creation. And I don't think without some kind of transcendent determinant, you can say that that's incorrect.
Well,
you can, unless you're predefining morality as that which, you know, whatever you said, promotes society. If you're saying what is ultimately foundationally right and wrong, it's circular reasoning what you're saying. You're saying what's ultimately right and wrong is promoting society because what's ultimately right and wrong is promoting society.
No. I'm saying morality is about your behavior and your behavior going to society. Okay, so let's say somebody else says, hey, I believe morality is all about, I'm not sure, what's the goal if they want to kill all the humans? What's their morality about? The earth, maybe?
Sure.
Okay, so somebody else says my morality is about treating the earth as number one, and humans are a threat to that, so we should wipe out all humans. So it's okay.
Right.
Okay, that's fine. That's your definition of morality. This is my definition of morality. Let's discuss it and see who has a better definition of morality. That stuff kind of works out. The problem, though, when you get into religion, is you get Christians saying that morality comes from God. There's a moral philosophy called divine command theory where God said it and therefore it's right. You don't think about it. God just gives these commands.
I agree with divine command theory on an ethical foundational level. Now, when you're talking about political theory and the application of that foundational ethic or that philosophical ethic, that's a different issue. But as far as because morality assumes the fact that a behavior can be right or wrong, it assumes that something is of value,
not just
utilitarian use.
The value is
some kind of transcendent value.
No, not transcendent. The value is just in society. I mean, like I said, math is about numbers and morality is about behavior, and the behavior is in regards to society. So if you want to say morality is something else like saving planet Earth, that's a disagreement we can have.
Right, but who's to say who's right, though, is what I'm saying. How do you know who's right in the end? I mean, you don't believe that we're both right, do you?
No. That's like saying if one person says math is about numbers and somebody else says, no, I think it should be about the way you dress, discuss it and see which way it makes more sense.
Well, that's fine, but what I'm getting at is one of them is correct and one of them is incorrect.
I think morality is just a term we put on behavior, and then so you have to figure out how do you define your behavior. And I'm saying that behavior is defined by what's good for society, and you're saying well, somebody else might say it's about the earth. I don't know any groups that are like that. I don't know of anybody that says we should kill all humans because it's an analogy you're bringing up, but it doesn't seem real world analogy.
It doesn't matter philosophically, and I would suggest that it's not that far out of the realm of possibility.
But the real world problem is Christians who say, oh, no, it's not about anything you might think about. It's all about what God tells you. You're not allowed to think about it. If God says do it.
That's not what I'm saying either, because now you're talking about how you actually apply it, and I'm not saying it's just what God tells you. But
that's divine command theory.
But I'm talking about the philosophical foundation for ethics. Mm-hmm. Is when you try and say that, you know, society is the ultimate thing worthy of protection and promotion, you're making a massive assumption there that you're calling self-evident, but you have there's no way to prove that. There's no judge, no one to say you're right and this other person's wrong.
Right. I just say it's by definition. I think, I just say, math is about numbers by definition. Morality is about the society.
That morality is about behavior, but what I'm disagreeing with you about is the presupposition that society is that thing that is the most deserving of protection and promotion.
Well, I don't see anybody advocating for anything else to compete with it in real life.
Well, of course you do. You see people who are more interested in themselves than society all the time. That's an exaltation of an individual over society.
But I don't think anybody's arguing that for morality.
it doesn't, well, people will argue all kinds of things, but it doesn't matter whether or not they actually argue it. We're talking about.
No, I think, well, no, I think the people in society do agree it's about the community. And if people are selfish, then they know, well, I'm doing something wrong, and I'm gonna see if I can get away with it. They know that's wrong because it goes against society.
Well, this is, it's all pretty obviously circular reasoning to me, but that's fine. We can move on. I'm curious, okay, then, if I just assume that society is the thing most worthy of, you know, directing our behaviors towards, as a atheistic evolutionist, how do you overcome determinism?
I don't see what how does that relate to it?
Well, even Provine acknowledges that there's no such thing as free will if evolution is true.
What does that have to do with anything, though?
Because unless there's something, the idea of free will is it transcends the natural law.
Yeah,
something,
I mean,
causes another, and there's no ultimate deviation from that. It just, there's no ought, there just is.
Right. Yeah, I know the free will and determinism is a big subject. Basically, if you say you don't have free will, then why even put anybody in prison? Because that's not really their fault, because they didn't have free will. I mean,
because a lot of these things, no one's that foolish to live that out. But I think if you're being honest to the worldview of atheistic evolution, that's what you're left with.
Well,
that free will is just an illusion.
The reason why people say that things are determinate is because of physics, the advance of physics, how accurate it is. It prescribes things. And they say, well, if you knew everything about everything, you could probably calculate everything in advance, even your thought processes. But then a counterpoint to that now is with quantum mechanics, where there's indeterminate states of, like, for example, the position of electron. They say it's indeterminate, and it's not known until the waveform collapses. So there's actual...
Well, I'm not talking about knowing things. I'm talking about the actual ability to break causality, to be able to break cause and effect. Because that's what you have to do for free will, right? You have to be able
quantum,
to say, I'm not just going to respond to this naturally. Yeah. I have a choice.
Well, actually, at the quantum level, they say cause and effect is broken, too. There's Richard Feynman one time said, you know, the philosophers hate this, but it's like, deal with it. That's nature. You don't understand it, but that's it.
Yeah. Well, I've heard stuff like that, too, but essentially what ends up happening is if you go to the quantum level like that and you start making claims like that, you're throwing logic out the window, and there's no, you can't even make that claim then because it starts self-refuting itself.
Yeah, but that's Feynman's point, is that, sorry, I'm sorry that you don't like it, that your logic has been busted there, but that's quantum mechanics. You know, that's what's going on at the quantum level. And the universe is bigger than our little brains sometimes.
Yeah, so what that's ultimately saying is we have no way of having any of these conversations because we really can't
distinguish
anything.
Well, we're not at the quantum level, so that doesn't really relate to morality so much.
Okay, so then it doesn't apply to the situation.
Mm-hmm, right.
So you still can't transcend determinism unless you're a quantum entity, I suppose.
I don't know. I'm not really. I think this thing about free will and determinism is a whole nother subject. So.
But it's a huge problem for an atheistic evolutionist. That's a huge issue if you're trying to... Now, it's not a problem if you're like Provine, and I would suggest more honest with reality and the consequences.
Well, I've never heard anybody say... I've done a lot of Christian-atheist debates, and I've never, ever heard any Christians say, like, this is a major problem you got to confront.
Well, they sure should be. How do you overcome that? If all that exists is the material and the natural laws, they're just playing out. They just are.
Yeah.
So how do... I mean... I can easily say from a, and you'd probably call it God of the gaps, but I can say certainly if God exists, that it would make sense that he would be able to ascribe some kind of transcendent ability to make a choice. But without that, some external force inserting that in, you're kind of left just, well, it's just an illusion that we have free will. And I think a lot of scientists say that. A lot of evolutionary scientists will acknowledge that. They just say, well, it's totally impractical, so I'm gonna act this way over here in my field of study, but then when I go home, I'm gonna protect my wife and kids like you know, I have the ability to and the choice to do certain things.
I don't know. I think there's a lot of absurdities in thinking things like God knows everything, because if he knows everything, it wouldn't make any sense to actually create anything. Why would he bother creating anything when he already knows in exact detail everything that's going to happen at every microsecond? That doesn't make any sense. And since he can't do anything, now he's totally bored to death because he already knows everything. I mean, if I was going to see a movie, it's entertaining to me because I've seen it. If I've seen it a million times, that would get sickening to me. But God knows it like a zillion up to the zillion power times. He knows every second, every microsecond of what's going to happen.
I think that's a little off topic, don't you?
Well, I mean, it's just
that,
kind
that
of,
has nothing to do
I mean,
with morality.
Yeah. I mean, just talking about the absurdities of like determinism and all that you're saying. Okay.
Oh. Well, yeah, I mean, then you're dealing with God's motives, and I'm certainly not qualified to tell God why he does things. But
okay.
I think that's a big issue is you've got to get, I still struggle greatly with the idea that humans have worth and value. I mean, I used to do all kinds of immoral things because, I didn't really think that from a philosophical level people had worth and value. Now, inside, I would suggest now from my perspective that we all have that inborn within us as given by God. But really, on a naturalistic level, there's no way to really ascribe any kind of anything beyond some temporary utility to society or humans. But then you also have no free will. So the other question then is, what would your source of, I mean, because I assume you agree with some sort of exclusive morality, correct?
What do you mean by exclusive morality?
Well, the term that's more popularly used would be absolute.
Yeah.
But you're not,
or objective.
Do you believe in relative morality?
Yeah, of course.
But even so,
the right moral thing to do is whatever would be less painful. So for example, is raping a baby ever bad? Well, it could be good thing to do if the alternative, if you have two choices and the alternative is worse. If your alternative is you have to rape a baby or nuke a city with 10 million people, which is the moral choice to make?
Right. So ultimately what you're doing there, though, is you're kind of changing the definition, and I wouldn't even call that relative morality. I would call that a very intricate application of morality.
Well, that's a moral question, though.
No, it is. But hear what I'm saying on this is that so when I look at true relative morality contradicts the law of non-contradiction. Because what happens then, you know, law of non-contradiction, nothing can both be and not be at the same time in the same respect.
Right.
What you're doing there is saying, what you're changing qualifiers on that statement, you know, which is why if you want to come up with an absolute moral thing, it's like, you know, they say something like it's never okay to torture a child for pleasure without, you know, any, you know, whatever, you know, they make these very specific claims. Because you can ultimately add qualifiers to any statement to get around whether or not something is moral, you know. But you're not actually positing a singular thing. You're talking about two completely different things, like raping a child for fun versus raping a child to save the rest of humanity. That's not a one for one. You know what I'm saying? You're taking a similarity, but then tacking on extra qualifiers to actually change it.
Well, I think all they're doing when they ask a question like that, like, you know, absolute morals exist. There's these laws that are always cannot be, they're just like written in heaven or something. And so, for example, they say raping a child for fun. What you're doing is you're picking something that is so obvious. So it's
right,
like, okay.
You have to.
I mean, it's for example, it's like saying abortion is always wrong. Why? Well, if a baby has been in the womb for 9 months, is about ready to pop out, and you kill it, obviously that's abortion, that's murder, right? Well, of course it's murder. You're picking an obvious case where that's murder because it's a second before it's born. Obviously, probably almost everybody would say that's murder.
And a lot of people don't think that's murder.
What's that?
Well, I mean, even the example you just gave, you've got partial birth abortions, which, you know.
No, I'm talking about, like, yeah, but I'm talking about something even more. I'm just saying take an obvious position. An obvious position is one second before it's born, 9 months, it's totally ready to be viable and everything. And if you kill it then, of course, it's murder. And so they would say, therefore,
murder. A lot of people would disagree with you there.
What's that?
A lot of people would disagree with you on that. I don't. I think you're dead on.
I don't think anybody would justify a woman carrying a baby all the way to 9 months. It's about ready to be born, and she decides to have an abortion. I think everybody, almost like 99.9%, would say that is murder.
Are you not familiar with partial birth abortions?
Yeah, but that's not 9 months, like I said.
Or what about Peter Singer? I mean, you know what he talks about and advocates for?
Okay.
The Princeton ethicist. He says, mm-hmm. you know, because ultimately the idea is that the child is not really viable until they're over a year old. So technically you should be able to kill a child at a year. And anyway, this is all kind of off topic, but
I understand what he's saying, and I think it's an interesting discussion. It's something to argue about. I think it's extreme. I would probably argue about it, but I think it's an interesting discussion to have.
But here's the problem with relative morality, and I think I agree with you on something, Bernie, that there is a tendency to oversimplify that Christians are certainly guilty of, and I would suggest atheists are as well. But there is a absolute morality. Oh, it's written in, you know, the Bible, and so that means it's law, and that's it. You know, that's end of story. I don't think the Bible even presents itself that clearly.
And one of the things that's really ridiculous, too, is like on abortion, like the Catholic stance is that any kind of birth control is bad. And, for example, if a woman uses the pill, that's abortion, that's bad. I mean, to me, that's ridiculous.
Well, are you familiar with the workmanship principle?
No.
Locke's workmanship principle. Essentially, it says that the creator, only a creator can ascribe value to its creation. That was John Locke. And it's in our Declaration of Independence, by the way, although slightly adjusted to accommodate for Bentham's utilitarianism. But they, we hold these truths to be self-evident. Endowed by our creator, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. So the idea there is that value and worth are ascribed by the creator, which is what I was trying to point to earlier. But what happens with, because I've actually done a little bit of conversation on bioethics, and you get into some really hairy issues with that, because the question ultimately becomes, it's not whether or not it's life. I think any one of us would agree that A, it's human, and B, it's life, even in embryonic stages, right? The question is whether or not that life has value worthy of protection. And at what stage we are incapable of discerning the value difference between an embryo and a 9-month-old baby.
Okay, well,
arbitrary.
We really went a lot of overtime on this one.
Okay, sure. No
problem. How about if we go on to the next one?
Yeah, that's fine.